very much, and thank you so much for having us here as guests at beautiful Fresno State University. It's a little unusual to speak before we play, but I think it's appropriate because this year marks the 80th anniversary of a very famous piece by Percy Grainger, Lincolnshire Posy. He composed this in 1937, much of it while he was on a train on a tour across the United States. And it had its premiere almost 80 years ago, almost 80 years ago in 1 month, March 7th, 1937. Grainger emigrated from Australia to England and then finally to America. While he was in England in the early part of the 1900s, he collected a lot of folk songs using an Edison wax cylinder recorder. And he captured this, the voices, the spirit, the character of these folk songs from the folk singers from the Lincolnshire area of England. Many of these tunes had never been written down before. So 1905 through 1908, he's collecting these tunes. Fast forward to 1937, he's asked to write a piece to be premiered at the American Bandmasters Association in Milwaukee. And he remembers these tunes, and so he cast six of them for this particular occasion. The first movement is called Lisbon, the text of which tells a story about a sailor and a young lady who is with child, and she's begging him to please stay, and he's going, no, no, the Navy is calling. So this tune, you'll hear a really lovely tune repeated a few times, and in the middle of it, you'll hear the Duke of Marlborough fanfare blast through as if to signify the Navy's calling. He ends up leaving, by the way. Second movement, Corkstow Grange. This tells the story of a local tragedy, a valet who couldn't take his master's abuse anymore, and after being struck once again by his master, he turns around and clocks him and kills him with one punch, with one blow. So it's kind of a morbid tale, but yet ironically, Grainger sets it to some of the most beautiful music ever written for the windmill. The third movement, Rufford Park Poachers, we're playing version B, by the way, for you band directors out there. Grainger couldn't decide the particular scoring that he wanted to use for this. He came up with a version A and a version B. We chose version B because it features Grainger's favorite instrument, the soprano saxophone. The one he called the most closest instrument to the human voice. And Grainger himself is a fantastic piano player, but he also taught himself how to play the saxophone, and his favorite was the soprano. This particular movement is challenging because in an effort to capture the freedom with which these folk singers sang their tunes, Grainger used a really sort of an odd combination of mixed meters. So every measure seems to shift in time and in feeling. The fourth movement is The Brisk Young Sailor. Again, it's a sailor and his young lady, but this time the sailor's a good guy. And if you can just sort of picture as you're listening to this, two lovers frolicking around and they're about to be married and they're playing hide and go seek, you'll hear a lot of canonic imitation that will capture that spirit. The fifth movement is Lord Melbourne. This one is unique in that Grainger wrote a piece that has no time signature at the beginning. And this, if you can picture an old retired general, he's laying on his deathbed, but somehow he musters up the courage to finally tell the world that he was a noble Englishman, his name is Lord Melbourne, and he never lost any victories. The final movement is The Lost Lady Found. This is a dance tune. It's repeated nine times. Each time there's some sort of a variation in the harmonic background or structure. And with that, I hope you enjoy our performance of Percy Grainger's Lincolnshire Posy. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Elegy, when he was commissioned to write this piece for the New York State Music Educators Association conference, he chose the title basically because he wanted to write something completely different from what he had been writing up until that time. Things like blue lady, incantation and dance, variations on a Korean folk song, things that had a lot of bombast to them. Instead, he elected to write something that was more solemn in nature. And so he wrote this piece in 1972. He heard the premiere performance, and he heard the second performance. And then unfortunately, shortly thereafter, in an unfortunate twist of fate, as life would only have it, he lost his life in an unfortunate accident. He was electrocuted in his backyard at the age of 40. So this turned out to be one of his very last compositions. It's absolutely gorgeous, beautiful colors. We hope that you enjoy our performance of The Chance Elegy.
Thank you.
eventually became part of a four movement suite called Four Places in the West. If you've ever been to Zion National Park, you know how just unbelievably beautiful it is. This particular piece, Welcher uses two primary themes. The first one is called Zion's Security, and it's a very innocent, fragile setting in F sharp minor to begin with. This blossoms into a full statement from the ensemble, and then it eventually gives way to sort of this driving rhythm in 3-4-4-4, back and forth. And it's a minor scale that's all clumped together. It's some very interesting cluster harmonies. This eventually gives way to a really beautiful setting in 7-8 of horn solo of Zion's Walls, the very famous tune that Aaron Copland used in A Promised Land. The driving rhythm comes back. The two themes are sort of intermixed along with that driving rhythm, and it comes to just a gorgeous, glorious climactic conclusion. One of the devices that Welcher uses in here to depict the echoing of the canon waltz, there's a lot of canonic imitation that you'll hear, this sort of an echo call, if you will, of sound bouncing off the waltz. We hope you enjoy our performance of Zion.
Thank you.
and the Fresno State Board of Directors, we would like to present Sonoma State a gift basket and a plaque commemorating their performance with us today as a thank you for sharing the concert with us. From the Symphonic Metamorphosis on themes of Carl Maria von Weber, written by Paul Hindemith. Hindemith emigrated to the United States during the World War II, and he settled at Yale, and while he was at Yale, 1943, that he was asked to write a piece. Actually, it started out as a ballet piece, and then he ended up scrapping that original idea and landed on this particular idea to compose this symphonic work. It's truly one of the great orchestral masterworks of the 20th century. If you don't know this work, that's your homework tonight, is to go home and find a fantastic recording of the of this particular entire symphony. While he was at Yale, he befriended Keith Wilson, who was the director of bands there. Upon hearing the premiere, Wilson approached Hindemith and asked if he might be able to orchestrate this for band. Hindemith gave his blessing, and it took him a while, but we finally came up with this march, and then this was such a hit that he approached Hindemith about maybe arranging the entire suite, which he did a few years later, and it's truly one of the great transcriptions in the band repertoire. We hope you enjoy our performance of the march from the Symphonic Metamorphosis, and thank you so much, Gary Gilroy, and the Fresno State Band and everybody that's here for your gracious invitation. We really enjoyed performing for you this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.